Welcome to the GETIT Integrative Arts series on control techniques. Now in this video segment, we're going to be teaching you 25 plus different control techniques that you're going to be using in different situations. And I'm going to read directly from the chart that you're going to get with this video. The goal of these techniques is to give you a working knowledge of applying control holds and locks in a variety of situations. It is important to note that generally locks and control holds should be used when you are superior to your opponent. And you always have the option, if a lock is not working, to release or to strike, based on the situation and what is reasonable at the time to defend yourself or to protect others. So again, it's very important that we're working with these techniques. These are all tools, just like a mechanic has in his toolbox, and you want to be able to read the situation first, then pull out the appropriate tool that best fits that situation to achieve your goal of maintaining control. We're going to be teaching you a lot of principles along with these locks, and the principles are just as important, if not more important, than the locks themselves, because if you understand, just like in mechanics, if you understand the principles of mechanics, then the tools become very flexible. If you just understand tools, then you can only use the tools in a very limited number of situations, and when a tool doesn't work, you go, oh no, it's not working, because you put too much faith in the tool, not enough faith in yourself, and your goals and your ability to adapt your techniques to fit the situations to achieve your goals. So with that in mind, we're going to go ahead and move into the control techniques at this time. First technique we're going to be doing today is a gun disarm. Now it's very important to realize that the gun is a tool to achieve a goal, a technique to achieve a goal. So when somebody pulls a gun on us, we want to immediately assess, what is their goal? If their goal is to shoot us, they're going to start pulling that trigger as soon as they see us. The person that comes up and puts that gun in our face and our chest, their goal is to use it as a tool to intimidate us, maybe to take us off someplace in the desert and then kill us, maybe to get our money, but again, we have to assess that rapidly. So again, playing with these things in safe space is very important instead of confronting it immediately in an unsafe space situation. We're going to show you a number of different options in this situation that you want to work with. In some cases, it's best to give them your money. In some cases, it's best to take the gun. In some cases, it's best to take them out. Again, it really depends upon what's available at the time. Now, in this case, Dave has got the gun in my chest, in my face. First thing I want to do is I want to move my body off the line of that position. Okay? So just by rolling my hips this much, turning the body, the waist, I've moved that projectile into open space. As I do that, so again, my waist is turning. He's going to give me a command. Julie's going to give me a command. Give me your money. Put your hands up. As he does that, I'm going to affirm that I'm going to follow that command. I'm going to say, okay. And I'm going to apply three principles that we're going to apply throughout this entire series, and that is I'm going to take control. Okay, so I'm taking control just by knowing that I have more options than just staring at this gun and being petrified by it. I have options. I have hard options. I have soft options. I have options that can move laterally off the line of that gun. So again, I can stay inside or outside based on the situation. I can move offensively or defensively. So again, and I also have verbal options as well. So he gives me a command. I say, okay, I'm going to take control mentally by having my own center, my own goals clear. I'm going to break his balance. And after I break his balance, again, you can see I'm using these two fingers primarily to break the balance. As I do that, I'm going to cause pain. The pain will take away his energy and put me even more in control. Now, as I break his balance forward, his instinctual reaction is going to be pull back. And I'm going to ride that energy back, placing my hand underneath his right hand, and immediately starting to turn up and coming in with the wrist throw. Okay, as you can see here, I'm using the same two knuckles underneath the hand. As we talked about before, I'm not sticking to the gun or I'm not sticking to the hand, because I want these hands open as I take this forward to be able to disarm that immediately. From here, we can do all sorts of follow-ups. We can come back up through the head. I always gonna be very cognizant of where that barrel is at. Back down the face again. You can see I'm doing a one-arm wrist throw here as I'm following up with the gun. Once I got that advantage right there, I can get my space, and now I've got control. And again, I want space when I'm taking control between him and this gun. So again, the wrist disarm, very simply. Body turns, same time the hand turns, okay? As soon as I do that, again, I'm bringing both hands up, my other hand's coming up, coming back. I want to come, depending upon, you want to think about the situation in terms of other participants. If you have your girlfriend, your wife, a friend here, well, I don't want to generally have that gun pointing toward them. I want to make sure that, again, there's open space there. If there's a bad guy over here, somebody who's a member of that party, I can take that gun and sweep it across. But I'll, again, be very aware of where that gun, where that bullet is going to be pointing or where it may hit anywhere in that radius. If there's any person who's an innocent bystander in that radius, I don't want that gun going in this direction at all as I go to take it. I would then take that, pull, and bring it over the top so it's coming up in this arcing pattern and then back down and then back through the face and back into the position. Again, we could take this to the ground and throw him and lock him up into that full lock throw that we showed you on the previous tapes, but that would not really be safe in this situation unless you've really practiced that tremendously, you know, day in and day out to get that down. Again, I can also take this, I can also bring it back through his throat, through his face, again, with either position to help me with that process. And again, I can use the flat of the gun to strike, I can use the tip, but again, I want to make sure I'm always aware of where the projectile of that bullet is pointed at. Let's show that to you from the other side. Again, first thing I want to do is I want to work on just turning my body off that line, okay? And again, I want to generally look him in the eyes and break that balance, immediately take it back, come down. If the gun drops and you lose it, that's fine. Just follow up with other empty-handed strikes. Again, in any situation, as you role play it, you're going to find different things happen from time to time, and you want to, you can't stop in the middle of it and go, well, that wasn't supposed to happen, because in the street, you want to be prepared for the unpredictable, for everything to go wrong and everything to go bad, but you keep moving towards your goal of taking control. That way, no matter what goes wrong, if a bullet goes off, you get in the arm, you get in the body, you can still live, you can still survive, and you can still move forward to achieve control in that situation. So again, guns in the face, guns in the chest, either one. Again, he says, give me your money. Again, immediately, I don't want to do this. I don't want to move my hand first, because now this has got to come all the way across my body. I got to pull that all the way across the body. Good chance you're going to get shot someplace. I want to turn that body immediately to get that off the line. Very important first motion. Coming back, take, keep control at the wrist, come up to the mastoid, back of the head, come back down, and then again retreat from that position. Okay, so that is the gun disarm with the wrist throw. We're not going to show you the inside position. More of a gangster type position. He's got the hand in this position. Automatically, what this does is puts me on the inside. So instead of coming this way, his hand is almost to a half lock position now. So as he says, give me your money, again, I'm going to turn the body immediately. So I'm off the line of that barrel, that projectile, and oftentimes when you do that, you want to look and see where does that projectile continue out towards. As I turn the body, again, I'm going to catch the wrist on top with primarily these two fingers, again, breaking the balance a little bit. I'm turning the hand over to a full lock position. So my left hand's coming up underneath the ridge of those knuckles. There's the hand again, vertical position, you can see where the gun's at. Keeping that barrel, cognizant of where that barrel's at, the hand comes out to take. You can see it's pointing toward him. Again, pushing into the full lock. Again, once I'm in that position, I continue to take him to the ground or I can push him away, get my distance and that range to where I have control of the situation. So again, one more time from this angle. I'm in this position, I want to turn to the inside, slap that out. As I slap it out, I want to pull slightly to break that balance. Take immediately, break the balance, and disengage. Okay, show that from the other side. Again, same thing. Guns in this position. Depending upon range, very important, I may have to move my body and my foot because of the distance there at that position. At that position, he may go to hit me with that left hand. I need to be able to pull back out. This is where, again, you role play with these movements. Try to play with the principles. Try to adapt them in as many different situations as possible. Try to think, just don't stick with the basic technique. Get the basic technique down, then try to think what can go wrong in the situation. What are some other factors that we can add in that you have to then problem solve so you're paying attention to the trifles of the movement. Now, next thing we're going to do is we're going to show you another very interesting option with this, and that's again where the person has the gun from the side in the side of the head, okay? Now, in this kind of position, again, this is actually a particular technique here was actually on an episode of Cops, where someone had actually come up and wanted to rob a guy, wanted to take his car, and he came up, put the gun in the side of his head, the side of his neck, and said, "Give me your keys." He said, "Okay," and he blocked the arm and he punched him. Now, we'd recommend palm striking to the chin or punching to the throat because of the seriousness of the situation. That simple technique, again, because of the position, he's inside, he did an hour block. So again, moving the head off the line, moving the head this way as the gun goes that way, blocking and punching, okay, depending upon the target area you want. His adrenaline pumped, he had a clear goal. His adrenaline was sky high. He did a very simple technique, an hour block and a punch, but he blocked so hard, the gun went flying over an 8-foot fence. He punched the guy so hard, he knocked 3 or 4 of the guy's teeth out. And then after that, he proceeded to take the guy and basically drug him over to a phone booth, made him stand outside the phone booth while he called the police and waited for the police to get there to arrest the individual. So again, very simple technique. Very clear goal, directed his energy through a very simple technique to fit the situation to achieve the goal. So whenever we're dealing with something that's in a control situation, we want to keep our techniques very simple. And some of these techniques you may find in this video are difficult more than others. You want to work on those, get better at them, but use the techniques that are simple and effective and fast for you to take control of the situations that you encounter. Now in this technique, we're going to show you a defense against a two-hand chokehold. Mark's grabbing me by the neck, choking me. As he's putting that pressure on my neck, I'm going to bring my left hand up and grab the inside of his left wrist, although again, we could apply this both sides. As I grab that wrist, I'm going to take my right hand, take my middle finger and put it over my index finger, and I'm going to put that into the sternal notch of his throat. As I do that, I'm going to push my hips back to propel him away from me. Now that would be a release technique where I'm just releasing to get some distance to then take recharge of the position. Again, I'm pushing down on the sternal notch. I'm not striking into it, although we could strike into it for a more serious defense. Okay, so again, he's choking. As I push in there, again, I can also come in off the sternal notch into the carotid artery area. And again, I can trap that wrist a little bit tighter. So as I come off, I now have my half lock position. Okay, so again, as I push him off, I've got my half lock position. I immediately take him down and push or pull and take control that way in that method. Again, from the half lock, we can also, again, showing this from the other side, using these two fingers, I can go all the way to the full lock position. Again, the key is to take control, break balance, cause pain, and take him down as far as we need to, again, to where we have control of the position. So I'll show that from the other side as well. So again, he's choking me. Give me a little more distance and range. There's the half lock or the full lock. Then again, we take him into the ground in the position for the control. You can see I'm not gripping in here nice and tight. I'm actually using my fingers as pointers because if I was to start to lose control at all, I could actually strike. I could come to my arm bar. I could actually, if Mark was up in this position and he was resisting me greatly, I could actually kick the knee out with my other foot. So again, you can adapt your technique and use other techniques to assist you in your control techniques based on what other options or tools you already have in your tool chest at this point in time. Now in this technique, we're going to take the center lock that we had in the 16 handlock drill, and we're going to apply it in a couple of different situations. First, we're going to apply it against a crossed wrist grab, so right grab to right wrist. I'm going to take my right hand, I'm going to do an outward circle to counter grab his wrist. As I'm doing that, I immediately want to bring my left hand up and just push. I don't want to grab, but I just want to push into his hand to trap it, and I let my fingers lightly go over the hand, and I'm going to walk into his center, and I've got sometimes what we call three cranes. If you think of a crane, the right hand's craned, his right hand's craned, my left hand's craned, my elbows are down. Again, we have 90 degrees, and I take the slack out of the wrist, and I push and I pull, taking him to one knee, okay, or taking him all the way down into the ground position with that. Again, this is a center lock from a cross grab, whereas in the counter or the 16 hand lock drill, we did it against the same hand. So again, he grabs, hand comes up, I push in, you can see I push in, pull out, take him down immediately. We can also apply that if somebody's just tremendously strong and we can't even begin to get the hand around, then we use, go ahead and grab that really tight, Corey. You can, at this point in time, again, this is how you practice this drill when you actually work these. I want the person to grab so tight that I can't move my arm up at all in that position. Sometimes just a simple distraction, like running our hand up their arm like that, can end up taking their mind off of that strength, okay? But let's say the person, we're a little bit, our adrenaline is pumping a little bit too hard for us to do that, so he's got that grip really tight. Again, the way I test it is I want to first off push in that direction and see, can I go in that direction? And I can't go in that direction, so what I do is I'm going to take my right leg, kick the inside of the shin, just lightly like that. And again, that distracts the person enough, it distracts the mind enough to where it takes their mind off the hand and allows to put the lock on. And again, that was a nice way of doing it. If we wanted to do it a little more severely, then we just do a front kick into the inside of the thigh right here, or into the groin, which makes the lock even easier to apply from the center lock position. Okay, show that the left hand as well. Left hand grabs, and again, same thing, I counter grab. As soon as my left hand's coming up on the outside of the arm, my right hand's coming up to assist, I've got, again, my 90 degree angle. I twist the hand in this position. If you think about this, even if I didn't, if his hand was up here in this position and I didn't even have the wrist here, just by taking this part of the arm and twisting it in, again, I'm twisting those tendons and sinews, I can use that as my lock in itself. So you can see how important this is to twist the arm and take that slack out in the position. So again, as he grabs, I come up, twist, I'm locking. Again, very simple movement. I'm wrist locking here, coming here, and if he was in a position where he was very centered, as I'm in this position, and I get to this position, you're going to find this with certain people. You're going to get here and you're going to find, gosh, it's not working. When it doesn't work, you want to, again, use that Z principle. Take control, break their balance. So I push in a little bit, pull back a little bit. I just kind of Z like this, okay, until I get it in that down position. Again, you've got that front leg right here into the groin. You've got the front leg to the head. And again, at any point in time, if you start to lose control, you can go right to your striking methods. You can see here, gosh, look at that. Here we have an arm bar. So we start tying in to some of our other locks that we've used before that we can tie in to these control techniques. So if we're doing something, it's not working, again, we just adapt to one of the other locks that we're in one of our 16 handlock drill positions. Now in this technique, we're going to do the same side wrist grab. So Mark's grabbing my right hand with his left wrist, and we're going to apply the same full lock, center lock. From here, what I do is I cup my hand in that U shape, just like we did with the gun disarm, and I come to the outside of the wrist. We call this a tiger's mouth in the martial arts. Okay, I come up, I take it that direction, my left hand comes up to assist, and in this position, you can see his hand's going all the way over to the full lock, and then we push in and apply the principle. So again, as he grabs, you can see he's already breaking his balance on the grab. Most people do that. When they actually go to grab you, they will start to lean forward. What we do is we want to use that time to take control. He's grabbing for me, so I take control. I break his balance some more. So I'm taking control. I'm breaking balance. Once he's out of balance, it makes it very easy to cause pain and apply that full lock position. Again, if his wrist is a little bit more slack, as I come into here, I'm going to pass off. I'm going to, let's say for whatever reason, I don't want him to go in that direction. Okay? Maybe there's some reason I want to take him over here. So what I'm going to do is instead of turning over to the full lock, I'm going to bring my right hand up to assist. I'm going to grab inside the bicep and pull back into the center lock. You can see how we can use that to also move him to whatever position we want and then apply that. And this is applying it just like we did in the 16 hand lock drill, pushing those positions in at that point. Okay, let's do that one again. So again, I get to this position. At that point in time, I've got control of the wrist. At the same time, I'm avoiding that right hand and that right leg because if you remember, we use the two-finger walk. Well, instead of his fingers, if he goes to throw that right hand, I just put more pressure on the shoulder area. Okay, the left hand's then coming up to assist, and I can continue to push in that direction to stay away from the right hand, or I can bring him back this direction for the center lock, taking him all the way down. And again, at any point in time, I've always got other tools, like my knee, as you can see, if my knee's coming in here, it can actually bring him all the way down onto his back position, and my knee is right in his groin at this point in time, and I'm riding actually down the top of his thigh here into the groin to apply to any kind of type of groundwork that we need to do to apply to that position. Because do that from the other side as well. So again, right hand grab. So again, cross, same side grab, bringing the hand up, tiger mouth, point to the outside position. Here's our full lock. Again, you can see I'm not grabbing tightly. And same side grab, here's my pass off. Twisting back up the hand, pulling on the bicep to our center lock position. One of the things, again, you also want to remember is that when he's grabbed here very tightly, if he's grabbed tightly, we can use those same distraction techniques. We can use the leg kick. We can just use a light tap to the psoriasis to break the balance. Okay? to get the lock. Most of the time we're using locks because we don't want to have to actually strike the person. Again, we have different levels of force. So we have levels of force where we can just command the person and they leave or they get on the ground to where we have them in a safe position to protect others. Then we have the locks where we start actually applying pressure points and locks on the person. Then we have an escalation of force where we have to actually strike them or hit them with a reasonable level of force to take away their energy. Then we go back to the lock. And there are cases where you have to move all the way up to using deadly force, which in most cases is defined as anything that causes serious physical injury to the person that you're trying to stop. Now in this technique, we're going to show you the three finger, the walk forward, up and down from the 16 handlock drill. And we're going to use this technique when we need to take this individual out of an establishment or out of an area and move them to someplace else for whatever the situation might call for. Now I'm going to bring my left hand up and I'm going to tiger mouth it just like we did before. And I'm going to be turning the hand, pointing the finger in the direction he wants to go. And it's very important we do this technique not to come up, grab the hand, turn it, and then walk, because if we do that, we're not taking control, we're not breaking balance, we're not causing pain. So one of the things we want to do is we're approaching, we want this person not even to know we're there, or if we are there, we want to make sure that we are already in position walking that hand forward, out, and up, okay? So that way, he is having to stay ahead of us to get rid of some of that pain versus us getting all the way to here, him not feeling anything because he's going to jerk away from, he's going to jerk away that way, or he's going to jerk away that way from the moment. So again, as I'm walking up, I want to make sure my hand inserts. And again, I want to get used to not having to look at that hand. I want to be able to be aware peripherally of that hand as well. I want to be able to walk and immediately go forward. What I want to do is I want to almost feel as if I've got a stick in his back that's actually shoving him in that direction, propelling him, and he wants to run that way. Now, as I do that, I want to be aware that as I start to walk, he may go to hit me with that other hand, so I want to shoot up, okay? And then I also want to be able to point down, and I can take him all the way into the ground, if necessary, to take control of that position, and then apply whatever other technique I need to at that point in time. So again, let's demonstrate that from the other side as well. Back a little bit, again, I want to just work on practicing, walking up, watching the body, taking it up, forward, down, wherever I need him to go, to where I take that control. Now again, we may only use the forward walk, but we also want to be able to, because that's again our goal to take him out, but we may want to take him up, we may want to take him down, based on the situation that we're involved in. Now in this technique, what we're going to do is we're going to basically take the J positions. So the positions you used in the first tape, the inside J's actually, okay? And we're just going to be doing those from a different position, okay? This is actually where we're going to end up in the actual technique. Now we're approaching this person from the front and we're walking by them. So again, depending upon what the situation is, that we may want to just come by, maybe we want to be more covert. We're just coming along from the side here and we're going to take this position. As we do this technique, my right hand is going to be inserting along his body. My left hand is going to be grabbing those two outside fingers. And the first thing we're going to do is we're going to show you how this ties in with, we're going to start to come this way, we're just going to come back, two finger walk. And you can see I can just use the two fingers, I can also use my arm to help support the elbow with that lock to take him up, and then I can also have the two finger up as well. So if we're starting to walk forward, he starts to pull away, well, we just go that direction too, and then we walk forward again. So again, one of the things you want to learn to do is you want to learn to be able to ride the technique and go where he goes. Probably the most important one of the most important principles in the martial arts is that when he pushes, you pull, and when he pulls, you push. And no place better is there to learn that except in applying locks and control techniques. So again, I'm just approaching from this angle. My right hand inserts between the body. My left hand grabs the fingers, the two fingers here. And again, I start to walk this way, and then I walk back, and I come in this direction. Now, next thing we're going to do, I'm going to take that same approach, and I'm going to come in, and I'm going to step underneath the arm, and I'm going to come back. And this should look fairly familiar, the two-finger up J. And from this position, I'm using that again to break his balance forward. I'm using the elbow as a pointer. I want him to go back. I want him to go forward for that control. Now here again, I want to take the slack out this way. I want to take that hand, I want to turn it in. So I'm turning his palm towards his body. Again, I can use, if I want to use the slack here to get a little more pressure, I take the slack out here. And then again, I take this little finger. The pressure on the little finger is very important because that little finger pressure really ends up being the gauge okay, as you see right here, that really ends up making the technique work even more effectively, okay? So even though I'm using two fingers, it's that little finger that really plays an important role, and then I use that push and pull effect here, same way as before that we were practicing on. So again, I'm approaching in from the side or the front, I walk, I bring it up, and I come back. And again, this is called a twist lock when we apply this position. When we did it in the 16 hand lock drill, we moved from a different position, so we used the geometric J or reverse J to get into position for that. Next application, same thing. I'm going to continue to walk by him. I'm going to place this on my shoulder. I'm going to walk him around and bring it this way. So again, you can see same exact technique, just a little bit different approach. So you can take a lot of your basic techniques, apply them in lots of different situations, and see how one technique can grow into 100 techniques if you're applying the proper principles. Again, I walk by, I take the hand up, I'm moving in a little closer. Again, for demonstration purposes, I'm staying out here, but in actuality, we want to stay pretty close to the body. I'm bringing this hand up. You can see how I'm starting to take control. I'm starting to break that balance. Okay, bring that hand back. I bring it up. I set it on my shoulder. Then I bring it around, twisting that little finger around, just getting him to walk in a U position into here. Another application, the same technique. We're walking along. I'm going to come up and in. Again, I'm breaking the balance here. I come over, I'm going to turn it, and instead of bringing it here, I'm going to bring it on up, and I'm going to place it over his shoulder. Now again, remember the finger is a pointer. I point the finger where I want him to go. Okay, so this is coming over the shoulder. I'm using my ulna and pointing that position. Okay, my right hand is here, always to assist, to strike, to trap that hand, okay, to palm the chest to help us take control of that situation. So again, I'm walking along, I'm coming up, hands coming over the body, throwing over the shoulder, and you can see from here, he's way off balance, very easy for me to take him all the way down, and I can use this right hand to assist. Again, I can always pull it forward too. Here's my arm bar, here's my full lock. So again, you can play on going into different movements. So this technique, we're doing a front approach using the two fingers, the two outside fingers, or the two back fingers, based on where the position is, and applying the J principle, the twist lock principle, and applying in different situations. Now all these techniques, you should apply to the left side as well. Some of those we will show you both sides, but you should be able to deduce very easily as part of your homework and part of your application process, the ability to transfer this to both sides. Now this technique, we're gonna show you the same side wrist grab. We're gonna be basically applying the two finger inside or outside up from the 16 hand lock drill. But we're applying against the wrist grab. I'm going to turn my palm up, so his palm is also up. I'm going to take my right hand, insert it right behind or at the base of the wrist. I'm going to push down. You can see I'm turning my hand, so my fingers are not going down. So I'm pulling him into my body again because I want to take control. A lot of times we have a tendency to try to push people away from us, but a lot of times the best place to have control is that right is in our center. So this is coming down, this is coming in. Again, I'm locking the hand here, and then I'm using the pressure on the fingers to take him up. This is called a standing wing technique. Again, it's the same as the two finger inside up or the two finger outside up. We're supplying it from the wrist grab, so I'm pulling it into my body and then applying it up. Again, I can use that generally just to throw the person away from me, again, as a release. Or if we wanted to take it into a control technique, I can take it up, and then I can take it into an arm bar, number 16. Or, in this particular technique, we're teaching something a little bit more complicated to give you something to work on. Again, I pull it in, turn it up. As I come up, I'm going to open the hands up and fan the hand. Now, my left hand is soft. That means it has to fan against the palm of his hand as my right hand's coming over. So his palm is now in a vertical position. His fingers are up. My elbow's down. My right hand is just touching lightly on the forearm. And I'm going to grip the hand. And again, the key here is the little finger. I'm going to use the little finger as a pointer towards that toe. Now, as I do that, I'm also going to pull him forward, which as you can see, when we do this quickly, my elbow would clip right at the back of the head or the temple. So when you do this with people, you want to make sure you avoid that by bringing the arm more down and avoid the twist into the back of the head with that elbow, unless we wanted more of a restraining technique. Very simple. When you're bringing somebody down very rapidly and you tap the side of that head with a forearm or an elbow, very easy knockout, okay, position. So, and I've actually knocked people out that way, so that's how I know. So I've experienced it, and the person getting knocked out, you know, it's such a quick movement because their head's jerking forward, and then it comes in from a different angle. There's a lot of concussion in the brain and a lot of whiplash effect. So again, as he grabs, I turn the hand over, I pull it in, I push up, I turn the hand, again, it's that fanning effect, and then I bring him down to the ground. Again, from that position, even from that position, I can let go, turn to my arm bar. So again, I can use my full lock to help me assist. I can pull him out more onto the legs. Again, at any point in time, I can just release and disengage as well. So again, you always have the options. Don't feel like you have to stay there on top of that person. There's times when it's better to disengage. There's times when it's better to shift to a different lock. Don't lock or trap yourself in. Okay, show that from the other angle. And let me go ahead and switch you out with Matt. Wanna come in, Matt? Again, same thing, same side wrist grab. We have a taller individual this time. Again, I want to pull his hand into my body, okay? If he's starting to pull me, well, then I'm gonna push it back and up and in. So again, I just get this riding effect. And you can see I don't have a hold of his hand at all, except with this basic pressure of the lock. So I don't need to grab the fingers at this point in time. So again, I can throw him away. I'm fanning the hands. My left hand is soft. This is a very natural process. My finger is now, his hands are going this way, and mine are this way, 90 degrees to his. My right hand is not gripping. If I grip the hand, that pulls my elbow up. I want to keep my elbow down. That helps, so I actually help pull with the elbow. And then my hand turns over. Once his fingers are vertical, I start to apply the pressure on the little finger across the body. Okay, which you can see on some people, depending upon their body structure, is more dramatic than others. And then I can turn that head in. You can see how that left elbow is right there at that position. Or I can go ahead and take him on down to the ground from an arm bar effect and lock him in from this position here. So as you play with these techniques, one of the things you want to do is you want to, again, this is not these techniques we're teaching you. We're not teaching you these as definitive techniques. We're teaching you the techniques as principles of teaching you the, or using the techniques is to teach you the principles of the movements so you can adapt them to various situations that you encounter. Let's try it with the other hand. Again, he's grabbed the wrist. Again, I pull it out. Again, I lock it up. I fan. This teaches very good sensitivity drills because like in the first tape, we want to develop a softer and softer touch all the time. Again, I'm starting to apply the little finger. I'm taking the pressure this way, this way, this way, all at the same time. Okay, and I'm breaking the balance. And you can see that elbow is right there at the back of the head, or I can intentionally miss that by just keeping my elbow out of the way a little bit. And from there, I can again pass it off to an arm bar or a shoulder lock as well. Because again, once that balance is gone, easy to take it from there. So again, we call this a standing wing, and we call it a kneeling wing technique. Now in this technique, we're gonna show you basically a variety of locks to apply together. We're gonna start with a same side wrist grab again. And again, this could also be, we're gonna apply this against a shoulder grab, cross grab. In this case, we're gonna come in, we're gonna start to walk this direction. So instead of staying here in a confrontational position with the person, again, we could go into very simple kickboxing, street kickboxing type techniques. We're going to cross away from this right hand, fold the arm. And you can see with this left hand, I'm not going to, I'm counting on his grip to basically allow most of this technique to work. You can see from here as his hand starts to fold, I'm bringing my left hand up behind his back, so my palm is up, his wrist or forearm is setting on my wrist, I'm pulling on the bicep to keep that elbow from hitting me in the head, and I let this left hand slip on up to his shoulder. So I'm basically applying a hammer lock and a shoulder lock at the same time. As I do that, I take my left hand, I want my wrist to fold in this way, and I can bring my left hand to, or my right hand to assist, and I bring him forward, so I'm putting pressure here, up on the arm, I'm putting pressure here on the shoulder as I'm walking him forward, or I can even take him on down into the ground position here as well for the hammer lock, shoulder lock. So again, I'll show that from this side. Again, he's grabbed the wrist. I'm going off the angle. I'm again folding that arm, and I can hit that, or I can actually just do it nice and soft. You're gonna find there's a little bit of pressure in this area. Does wonders for folding that arm. Again, my hand comes up underneath. My palm is up, my palm just rides up the back and comes forward and down. My right hand is in an assisting position. So again, you can see his palm is up, this hand here, this wrist action, just like we talked about in the first tape on just the 16 handle drill, is very important. That action right there in the wrist creates a great deal of movement. Then if I take one step forward, boom, okay, he's going down. If I walk quick, his head is in the ground. Now we're gonna do that same exact technique, okay, but we're gonna apply it against a cross grab. Now in a cross grab, I'm gonna take my right hand, and my right hand, again, is coming in this direction. If he resists here, again, I'm going to get that bicep to fold by pulling either down, striking down on it, or pulling it from up from underneath. The better technique, I believe, is coming up underneath the arm to pull down. And again, you can see my palm is going up. It's coming up behind the back. I'm gonna have Dave just kind of walk around this way a little bit so he can see better. My palm is up. My left hand is now going to slide down his arm as this hand comes up to the shoulder. This hand comes up to apply the turnover to the arm bar or the hammer lock. And then this hand, again, I'm applying the goose head here. And my right hand turns in an outward circle for the shoulder lock. So now we have a goose head hammer lock and a shoulder lock all combined in one technique to take him out and about. So again, different approach. Right grab. Again, I'm coming up to grab the arm. Hands coming up. Left hand's taking over. As you can see, very soft. If you do this too strong, it won't work. And now I'm behind him and taking him out wherever I want. I'm going to show you that same technique very slowly with his hands just down. I'm going to approach in from an off angle, so I don't want to approach him square. I'm approaching more with our shoulders lined up here, okay? And as I approach, my right hand's going to insert. My left hand's going to catch that wrist. You can see here, we're applying the full lock from that angular position, but by folding the arm up along his palm, up along the back, and turning, we now have the goose head, shoulder lock, hammer lock combination. So again, very simple technique. The key to it is being soft, fluid, turning, moving, and going. And again, we have him three quarters, we should have him three quarters of the way where we want him to go before he even knows what's happening. Now same thing, he applies the grab on the shoulder. All I do is I take my hand, again, you wouldn't work this on somebody who's very tall, but I take my left hand up and I'm gonna turn his shoulder over, okay? So I'm applying the same shoulder lock. And you can see how his hand here is going to roll over into a full lock. So now I'm using a full lock, shoulder lock. In some cases he may bend the elbow, in which case he does. Then we're going into the goose head. We may end up in a goose head like this. So as you're doing these techniques, when you first practice them slowly, work the basic technique, but realize a lot of times it may turn into another technique. I have a lot of friends in law enforcement and security work, and they say oftentimes it's only the second, third, or fourth technique that they're moving through that actually ends up applying the lock based on what the situation is that they're encountering. So again, he grabs the shoulder, my hand comes up, and I'm actually turning, both my palms are up, both my palms, this hand's turning down, this hand's turning out. So it's like I'm turning both hands in towards each other at the same time to get this lock. And again, I've got the full lock, shoulder lock in this position. Now in this technique, we're going to teach you some very important principles. We're going to tie in with everything we've done so far. And in this concept, what we're going to do is we're going to work on Mark grabs my wrist tight, okay? I don't think I can do any lock again. I might try to move this way. He locks his shoulder up. Whatever the key is, his grip is so tight that I cannot do any locks on him. So first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to strike. Now, again, any kind of a strike, the important thing with a strike is not to use a lot of tension or muscular tension, but to use your bone structure. At this range, I might just do a tap to the leg. I might do a tap to this leg. Okay, I might, again, touch the psoas plexus. I might strike the groin. I might use that two-finger strike to the throat. But I use that to break the balance, then allow me to move into my half lock or my full lock position. Again, he might be grabbing my shoulder very, very tight. And he may even break my balance initially. So again, I want to ride that kind of position. And as I'm riding that position, I use my off-balance position to strike. So I might strike through the back of that tricep. Again, if you take somebody's arm, you just kind of hammer on the bicep a little bit, hammer on the tricep a little bit softly, though, using your bones, you'll find that is actually a very good way to disrupt the muscle, to disrupt the grip. And from there, after I do that, then I apply my lock, my arm bar. So again, what we want to do is, again, he may grab my wrist, for instance. Again, he's got a nice tight grab on it. So again, I can't get that counter grab to work. So first thing I do is I drop my weight and I push into the rib. OK, Okay. A lot of times, just that motion, you see, he started to react to that, okay, without my hand even getting there, which stretches the arm out, which now applies the ability to apply the arm bar or any of the other locks. Okay. Okay, Dave, let me borrow you. Okay, he grabs me on the left shoulder. Again, same thing, he's got this tight grab, a little bit different position. Instead of us being more square, we're a little bit more at this angle. Depending upon the length of the arm, I can again break the balance right here. I use the rib. Again, I'm just using my thumb. Okay, very good little technique to break the balance. And then to come over, bring the elbow over, and apply. We're going to be showing you that technique a little bit later. But the idea again is to use something to release, to distract his mind, throat, and then arm bar, full lock. Very, very good techniques for taking control. Matt, come on in. Let's do a cross grab. Again, cross grabs the wrist. Again, lock that arm up really tight. Don't even move it at all. He's in a position where I cannot move that arm at all. Okay? But look where my legs lined up. I just do a lift kick into his groin, lift kick into his thigh, break the balance. Now all of a sudden it becomes easy to counter grab. Again, with the arm bars, we might use the back of the hand, and then we have the position in. Okay? Another technique, he grabs here, and I'm way over here. Okay, in this position again, I can't even go that direction. So this is where other techniques in the martial arts come in. I might just do a little side kick into that shin here, a little side kick in the shin here to get that distraction to be able to then break the balance and apply the arm bar position. Okay, Corey, let me borrow you. For his last one we're going to show you, again, he's got a medium grab. Okay, let me bring it over here. I'm going to bring my arm up. This is called a rotary position. Very nice position to where, again, instead of trying to go around the arm, we just lift the arm up. And then from here, remember this little wrist action, we just cut down. Now again, you see I'm controlling the wrist. As I cut down, I can palm into the psoral plexus. I can palm into the groin. I can palm the chin lightly. Puts me in very close to then counter grip. So palms are very, very nice. Again, some positions it's better to go in with a straight hand, like you can actually use this ridge of the hand right here. You can use the thumb. You can use the knuckles like a punch, okay? Again, making sure your bone structures align. If you're coming in from a different angle though, it's better, again, see I'm using the wrist here, this action of the wrist to release here at the wrist. We can use the palm, again, to break the balance. Again, groin, psoral plexus, chin. We just use this, it's called a soft palm, to set up our position to apply any lock that we want to apply in the position, okay? Whichever direction we want to go. You can see there we're using the other full, the wrist throw or combining that into that horizontal goose head lock. So again, very important principle when you're applying any lock, it's not working, strike somewhere in that center, the groin, psoral plexus, chin, throat, push them away, even again low, shin, thigh, groin with the feet, to distract them, to take away their balance, to create some pain, and then go back into reapplying your lock. So it gets you a position where you don't have to just beat them to death, but you can again take away their energy so where your locks become more effective. Now in this technique, again, we're teaching you the same principles all the time. Take control, break balance, cause pain. It just depends upon what level of control we need to take, depending upon what level of force we use, how much pain we create. It really depends upon how much energy we need to take away from our opponent to get them to comply. And breaking their balance is just a natural part of the process that we want to apply immediately, maintain our own process. One of my friends in law enforcement says that when he applies these submission techniques and the person's complaining, quit hurting me, quit hurting me, he always responds with, quit hurting yourself, because once they comply, he won't have to take away or create any more pain to get them to comply. So again, the pain is really a measure to get them to comply and for you to maintain your control. Once they stop fighting, once they stop resisting, then you can take that level down to where you can cuff them or take them into custody or escort them out of someplace. Now this technique again is going to be against a wrist grab, cross grab. First thing we're going to do is we're going to apply a different movement. We're going to apply an arm bar kind of coming up with the tiger mouth from the side to throw them in that direction. Now we could take them right into a wall. We could take them down under the hood of a car. Again, this could also be applied against a shoulder grab. He's cross grabbing the shoulder. If my hand's on the inside of his arm, it stays on the inside of his arm instead of going to the outside. And again, the first thing I do is I take him into the wall or down under the hood of a car or onto a desk, wherever I need to take him. In this position, for whatever reason though, maybe he's able to stand back up because he's so strong. So as he starts to come that direction again, he's pulling this way, pushing this way, so I'm going to pull that way. Now what I'm going to do is my right hand is going to slip in this direction as my hand keeps control on the elbow, and you can see my hand is sticking to the back of his hand. And Tai Chi, they call that Chi Sao or sticky energy or sensitivity energy. Also in Wing Chun, they call it the same thing. My hand comes up and my palm is inside his palm. My left arm is still tiger mouth in the elbow. My forearm is going to move into his rib, and I can again hook the goose head here, or I can just let it slip off coming into here with the forearm and push. Now from this position, I can just again push him into whatever I want, or I can actually throw him away from me. So again, it doesn't matter if it's against a wrist grab or a shoulder grab, he could be grabbing the same wrist, same side wrist here. And again, I'm gonna move this off because again, my initial motion is to take him in that direction. And again, you can see I use that outside tiger mouth here, and then I passed up to the arm bar, and again, I'm pushing where the elbow folds. I throw that position. He starts to come back that way, I come back up, and then I take him again this direction. I'm cross-stepping to break his balance to take him in that direction. Let's show him that from the other side. Again, cross grab. Again, I rotary the arm up to again start to take this position. I then reverse back into this direction. So again, you can see my hand is kind of gathering or scooping. For any of you who are doing our Tai Chi series, you use a lot of the principles from the rooting and from a lot of the basic movements in Tai Chi to help you with your structure so you don't use your muscular strength. My arm is gonna fold in. I'm gonna walk him in this position. Again, I'm gonna run him or I can throw him away from me based on the situation. So this technique combines a lot of different movements. It combines a ward off type motion. It combines the goose head. It combines an arm lock from a different position. You can see just in this position here, that pressure allows me to take control and keep him off balance. I may not be causing a lot of pain, but then if I do different techniques where I apply different pressure points in the arm, you can actually add to that, to the pain in that area, just by something as simple as a grip. So like before when we showed you on this one, we were just twisting the tendon ligament, okay? Just doing something, pressing into certain areas of the arm, okay, can create more pain to allow you to break their balance and to take control. Now a lot of these techniques we're teaching against wrist grabs, shoulder grabs, but they can also be entered into from a lot of different positions. Now again, we're gonna do the same rotary motion here, supporting the elbow on the outside of the tiger mouth. I'm going to slap the arm down. As I do that, my left hand is going to insert behind the back. This is another way of getting into, you can see that shoulder lock, and his arm may end up here or may end up here. We don't really care because we're going to adapt our technique to fit the situation to achieve our goal. And again, we have our shoulder lock. In this case, we have a full lock position. So this kind of ties back to one of the earlier shoulder locks. What we're going to do that differentiates this from the others is that we're in this position. We're starting to do any of our locks that have to do with this shoulder lock, hammer lock, and maybe we start to see that left hand come up, okay, starting to hook at us. We're gonna come in to the groin with our knee or the inside of the thigh as we also palm the top of the forehead. Mike Tyson, when he knocked out Larry Holmes, used an overhead punch to the forehead, and after the fight, they asked Holmes if Tyson hit that hard, and he said, no, he doesn't really hit very hard, but when he punched me in the forehead, he said, I couldn't get my balance back. He said, it knocked out my equilibrium. I just couldn't get my balance back. So I got back up, but I could never regain control. So very good strike with the palm. Again, we palm to the head if we have to actually strike the head because we don't want to break our hand. Basic concept, I punch the concrete floor, I break my hand, I palm it, it stings. So again, my left hand's already up behind the shoulder, I knee, I palm, my right hand comes down and assists, and I come down into that arm bar, shoulder bar, full lock, whatever position I end up into to take him down and into the ground for the lock position. Okay, we're gonna show that to you from the other side as well. And again, it could also work against the shoulder grab as well. Again, I'm clearing the arm, moving it off. Maybe he pulls back away from it, I clear it down, I slap that hand down with a very soft wrist movement, pulling my elbow and my body weight simultaneously. My left hand inserts, I knee and I palm. My left hand, you can see, is coming up underneath the arm. My right hand, as soon as it palms here, catches down. This dual motion here gives us a little bit more whiplash. From there, I grab. My right foot's gonna step off, complete 90 degrees, to take him down into this position here to where I want him in the lock. So again, however you wanna practice the basic movement, because you wanna practice entering it into other ways. Again, we could be standing here arguing with the person, and I can enter right from this position. My right hand goes up, could actually catch up into the chin as I knee. You see my left hand's asserting in, then I'm up and I'm in position for my lock and my takedown. Now in this technique, we're gonna show you more of a top hand grab. Very important when you're practicing with these techniques, you wanna think of in terms of where is he grabbing you. Right now he's grabbing on top of my shoulder, which places my right arm completely free on the outside of the position. okay? If he grabs more on the outside of my shoulder here, I'm more on the inside position. If he grabs my shoulder here, again, that changes the technique a little bit. So you want to start thinking in terms of these trifles of where the hand grab is placed can really make a technique, a control technique, effective or ineffective. So on this one, he's got the hand on top of the shoulder. Again, he may be grabbing me to hit me with that right arm. He may be breaking my balance. What I'm going to do is I'm going to bring my right hand straight up as my left hand pins. And again, by pinning, I'm not grabbing tightly. I'm just trapping in to take control and break his balance. My right hand comes up and my right hand comes down. Now what it's doing is it's rolling on the outside of that elbow, and my hand is going to point directly at the ground, taking him to the ground. Now you can see I haven't moved my feet at all hardly. I'm going to step forward a little bit, okay, to take him down head first into the ground. So again, he grabs, I bring the arm up. What I'm doing here is I'm actually kind of rolling his arm, starting to roll it over right here, take it down into the ground, and from here I'm also applying the full lock position as well. Let's show that to you from the other side. Again, he grabs. Again, I'm coming up. My left hand is always, even though my left hand is coming here to pin, my left hand is also a guard hand against that right hand. Because that hand could be coming up to hook me, all I've got to do is be adjusting that. So if he hits me with that right hand, by doing this position here, I'm actually taking that right hand out of position. He's grabbed tight. Oftentimes when they start to lose control, they'll actually try to grab tighter. Okay, and my other hand is coming up for the takedown position into the ground. Again, you can see I'm using the full lock too. Okay, I'm going to use Matt in this one as well. Go ahead and come on in, Matt, because Matt's a lot taller than Mark. Again, he grabs me. Again, this position, I want to take that arm up first. See, I'm dislocating or disconnecting the shoulder position. Then I take it over and I take it down. So the size of the person doesn't really matter. The times when this technique won't work is if the person's got you in this kind of grab and the elbow's bent, because now I've got to move that arm way too much to bring it up and out, and he's going to have a natural tendency to pull it in. So it works better if his arm's already extended. He's grabbing, maybe there's a little bit of bend to the arm, or it's already extended, because at that point in time, all I've got to do is move a little bit, and he's actually breaking his own balance for me. So again, reading the situation is, excuse me, is very essential. If that arm is bent more, he's got to grab more in here. I'm not going to use that kind of technique. He's already pulling me into him, so I'm going to move in. Now, again, see, I've got the arm out, and I can go into any one of my other controlling techniques. I can even use that outside arm for one of the previous techniques we showed you, or the outside of the wrist here, and the forearm to the rib on the other side of the body. If you remember before in the other one, it ended up behind the body. Well, here it ended up in front of the body, but again, we're pushing away to retake control of the situation. Now in this technique, we're going to be employing the two-finger takedown that we had in the 16 handlock drill. And in this case, the person is going to push us. Now as he pushes, it's very important to learn to read that there's a lot of different types of pushes. This push would originally start from about the range of where we could use our feet barely to touch the person, or just a little bit beyond that, so we have some range to see that he's going to be coming with a long push. So I can see that push is coming, and my hand can very easily come up and catch that. This technique would not work effectively from a push at this range because it's going to be more of a popping kind of a technique where I'm not going to really respond. If I need to take control from a closer range like that, I want that hand somewhere in that center, so as his hands start to move toward me, I'm going to break that balance. That brings his arm forward and then allows me to apply any of the locks we've had previously. So again, if you're in close to the person, you want to make sure if their shoulder starts to rise, body starts to rise, break that structure. Again, take control, break their balance, cause a little bit of pain, the hand comes out, then that allows you to apply any of your locks. But again, for the two-finger takedown, it's coming from this kind of a distance. He goes to push, my hands come up, my left hand coming up to support, up underneath the arm, my thumb coming up into the hands. And again, I'm applying the same locks we did in the 16 handlock drill. I have this push, pull. Difference is that when we apply this technique, I'm going to take him all the way down to at least one knee, and most of the time we're going to take him all the way down to face down in the position. Again, see where my finger's at? Facing straight down to the ground. Now if we want to bring him back up, we just use our J, okay, back into position into our twist lock. We can easily move into our side twist lock here, which then takes us back to our overhead or our push forward movements of some of the techniques that you've learned earlier on. You can do that with the left hand as well. Again, he comes to push. My hand comes up. You can see I'm drifting away from that right hand. My left hand's coming up. You gotta be careful when you do this technique. You wanna do it fairly slowly initially, because he takes me down quickly like this. Not only is it painful, I actually had a student that used this technique in a self-defense situation last summer, and it was a fairly confrontational situation. The guy went to push him, grab him, And when he did it quickly and rapidly, he actually broke two or three of the guy's fingers. He ended up only actually getting these two, or he might have gotten these three, but two or three of the fingers actually broke because he snapped it so violently. So again, whenever you're doing the techniques, as he pushes, I want to make sure that my elbow stays down, shoulders stay down. I want to do it slowly. And at any point in time, if the pain ever gets too great, Mark will slap the floor, or he'll slap his body, or he'll slap me. He will slap anything because, again, as we talked about before in the first tapes, that's an indication that the pain is too great and we need to stop. Let's go ahead and show that from the other side as well. So again, he comes to push. I'm drifting back. Again, trying to get him to break his balance as he's reaching for me. And again, you can see he's extended out here. It's coming down and to the ground. Again, I can just use this as a pinning motion. You've got all these areas in the back that can be used to pin. I can even switch there and kind of put some pressure on the arm there, which is, again, nice and painful. One of the most important things when you do this, make sure they don't get their hand trapped underneath their body, because then they can't slap. Then they have to kind of just pat their head, or, again, he could actually slap with his foot if he wanted to. Anything he taps with, boom, boom. Again, so you want to become very aware, because in some cases, again, he may be in a position where he can not slap. This next technique is a very simple transition technique. He comes in to push me like before. I come to take it. As I come to take it, I start to push down. He starts to pull away. So again, when he pulls, I push. I want to just ride that hand right along inside the body. Again, you can see I'm still adjusting here. I'm going to walk here, rubbing the finger right along the body, come behind. So I've got a rear goose head with the two fingers. Again, from here, I can take him around. I can use my forearm to walk him, to put him wherever I want. So again, as he goes to push, I come to here. I start taking him down. He starts to jerk away. I run that body back in there. And again, in some cases, depending on how big they are, you may not get the hand to here. It may only get up into the armpit, which is just as good, because I'm using that same leverage there to be able to move him where I want him to go. At any point in time, if I felt like I was losing control, I would either try to come back to another technique, or I would push him away from me, maybe go to a few simple street kickboxing techniques, and then go back to my locking and controlling of the situation. And this technique, we're going to show you a different type of grab. He's grabbing the chest in this area. It's a nice tight grab. Again, depending upon the level of control we want to take, we may need to initially hit or strike. And you can see, as I'm striking to break the balance here, I'm also trapping the arm here. You're going to find that if you just practice a simple technique just by pushing in here, it's not a big deal, this is not a big deal, but when you apply the two together, okay, it just breaks the balance tremendously more by shocking this, breaking the balance here, disrupting the body's systems. Now in this case, what I'm going to do in this particular technique is I'm going to, as he grabs, I'm going to push into this area of the hand, because I want to push his hand. He's grabbing, I want to trap that hand in there even more. And I'm going to take my left hand up, and I'm going to put it right at where the wrist folds, and I'm going to apply that and pull that in as well. So I've got both hands pulling. Now again, remember, we want to take three directions. We pull in, now I'm going to start dropping my right elbow down. As I drop my right elbow down, I'm actually pulling down here, twisting this in this direction, so I'm still applying the pressure here, and I start to take the left hand across the body in this direction to take him down, almost like in the kneeling wing position. Now this is a very subtle technique, because we have to really keep that pressure on the hand here. Again, I'm pushing in, pulling down, twisting, and when you do this very slowly, you don't want to do this very quickly at first, because you don't want to injure the hand, you don't want to break anything. And we want to do very slowly, twist, turn, step back, pull down into the ground. Okay? Show that from the opposite side as well. Again, he grabs, nice tight grab. Again, I'm putting the pressure in here, dropping the arms down nice and tight, twisting, bring him down and in. Again, so when he grabs, a lot of times he's grabbing, he might be pushing me, I'm going to trap that hand, take it down, in one simple motion. And then again, we could follow up however we want. We could turn that into a shoulder bar, arm bar. You can see I'm putting that pressure in here, pulling him out, locking it into position. So again, once you take the initial control, you want to ask yourself, where do you want to go from there? What are you going to do once you have control? Are you taking him down? Are you going to cuff him? Are you going to move him out of someplace? You want to look at the strategy of the whole situation. And again, legally, what level of force are you entitled to use based on what level of threat there is within that situation? And then having enough tools in your tool chest to be able to adapt and be in control of whatever that situation dictates. In this technique, the person has grabbed us, and again, you can see I'm already on the inside position. So for whatever reason, I don't want to strike, I don't want to go back to my outside position, I'm going to just from here, because he's got a nice tight grab, I'm just going to come up and come through the face of the distraction technique. I can also come up and brush through the throat. Again, I'm just using that brushing motion to break the balance, coming over the top, catching the arm, and locking the elbow. Now in this case, I've locked the elbow. He had a looser grab, so it came off as I started to do it. What we're gonna do is, and again, that may happen, we want a really nice tight grab. And again, you can kind of feel the tightness or the looseness of the grab. I come up through the face, and a lot of times, if depending upon the level of control they have, they may let go immediately and try to back off, in which case you have to go after them to take control, or back off as well to give yourself more distance. Or in other case, you're gonna slap through that face, and because they're a very controlling person, they're gonna grab tighter, which is really where this technique works the best, and we're gonna end up having a V with the arm. And you can see this is very painful. It puts a lot of pressure on the shoulder socket. And then from there, again, if he goes to me with that other hand, I just move my body a little bit, okay? Also, this hand can come back. I can break the balance. This can actually become a full-fledged takedown. If the person doesn't know how to fall, if you're not doing any falling arts, then this would not be a good technique to take beyond this point because the person could be injured in the fall itself. But again, you can see I'm not using much pressure, and he's starting to go, losing that control, losing that balance. Okay, show it the right arm as well. Again, he grabs nice and tight. I'm already in the inside position. Again, I just break that balance. Doesn't take much to break most people's balance. Again, I come up underneath the arm, snaking it, getting a circle close to the body here, V here, locking it up. I can use my right arm to assist my left arm. I can also, from here, come back, move it into a full lock, which I'm using here, and the shoulder lock there. So again, learning to snake the arm through different positions, coming forward and back, circling it, is a very good way to also practice your techniques. One more time, he grabs. Again, we come up. Again, work it this way. Take it from there, and then follow up with the right hand to anywhere these open target areas. Or come back and apply your shoulder lock with your full lock for your takedown position. Now, this technique is a very simple technique. This technique is used for when somebody is gripping onto a bar and they don't want to leave a club, they're gripping onto a door handle, they're gripping onto perhaps drugs that you need to get out of their hand, they're gripping onto a weapon. You usually have other people to assist you in this situation who've already have control of the person, and your goal is to get whatever they have in their hand out of it. So the person who is coming to get this has to feel secure that they're not going to be able to hit them with anything else. They can really focus on the hand here. What we're going to do is we're going to take, if we're on his right side, we're going to take our right hand, come up underneath the hand, take our left hand and come over the top along the thumb, and we're basically applying sort of a pistol grip type idea on the thumb itself. So what I'm doing is I'm pushing with the back of my hand into the back of his base of his thumb, and I'm pulling in here. Very painful technique to open that hand up, okay? Again, we'll do it from the other side as well, so you can see a different vantage point. When I'm pushing from the left side, my left hand's coming up underneath the hand, my right hand's coming in. Again, I'm grabbing this like a pistol grip. I can use these two fingers, middle two fingers. I like to use those the best. Again, I've got the base of my hand pushing in here, and I push and I pull. You can see very, very painful. You can see the jolt to the body from that pressure on that thumb position. Again, this is a thumb lock release. Again, it works if he's gripping onto, again, something that he doesn't want to leave, doesn't want to leave someplace, and you need to release that thumb. Coming in nice and easy. Best applied, though, when you have other people to assist you with the technique and with the control. Again, this technique is a very simple technique that we're using in situations where people are having a sit-in or they're not going to leave and we need to remove them from the premises. We're going to come up in from behind and we're going to take our middle fingers or our index fingers and place them right at the base of the ear in the indentation. We're going to push in and then we're going to pull up on the skull. Once we get them up, then we have to decide what kind of a control technique we're going to use to move them forward. Again, this is basically a TMJ type lift, temporal mandibular joint lift. It's up behind the ear position. Again, I want to push in. You can see as soon as I start to push in, you'll start to see a pain reaction. And then I want to lift up to bring him up. And once I have him up, I want to then be able to use whatever restraining technique or controlling technique I need at that point in time. Go sit one more time. Another thing, if he's locked in position, his arms are locked in, okay, and I want to come in from an angle position, take him into a down position. I'm going to come in, I'm going to press into this area of the neck to go ahead and move him. That way I can get that arm out of there and continue to roll that body over. So again, we want to break that balance. To break the balance, we can use these spinal accessory nerves in here to press, to break, okay, to bring the arm out, to lock, down and in, to reposition for whatever we want. And again, from there, again, you can also come back up with your, using principles from your 16 hand line drill to bring them back in, up in a position to walk them out. Again, very simple techniques, nice, easy to use. Just the more you practice them, the better you'll get at them. Now in this technique, we're going to show you how to apply the arm bar, which we've actually been using in a lot of other techniques, from any position. So it's a very, very good technique to be able to get into, and we're going to apply some basic principles. Dave is at my 12 o'clock position. He cross grabs my wrists. I'm going to counter grab his wrist, step back. Again, the arm bar, I want to catch where the arm folds, and I roll the arm down and in position. Okay, so again, we just did it against a cross grab. We're now going to cross grab with the left hand. Instead of stepping back, which I could do just like before, I'm going to step in, pushing up on the elbow, again with the tiger mouth, then roll it over to the back of the hand. So one of the things, or back of the arm. So it's important to realize that when I'm doing the arm bar, I can use it with the palm up behind the elbow, or like we showed on this side, I can pull in with my elbow and go right to my two bones or my one bone. Again, you can also grab, same side grab, I can use my tiger mouth, pass off to my right hand tiger mouth, move up, use my palm, or again, my ulna or two bones. I can also use that pass off with the knuckles of the arm, again to push, pull, again using a combination of techniques. I can also pull into play, taking the leg out that he's got his weight on, because that's the one that's holding the body up. Again, same side grab with the opposite side. So what we're doing is we're doing cross grab, cross grab. We're staying at 12 o'clock. We're staying linear with these movements, staying on the same line. Okay. Although if we want to open it up a little bit, when he grabs my shoulder, okay, again, cross grab here, I could come to the outside position. Because my arm is already on the inside, I'm going to stay there. I'm going to brush the arm up, and I can step again straight back, 12 o'clock, or I can now move laterally, stepping with my right foot all the way around beside him to take him down, and then to push back in. Again, you can see I'm using the full lock and the arm bar here. So again, we can employ the principles of linear movement or lateral movement. Again, he cross grabs with his left hand. My left hand stays inside. My right arm comes up. Instead of staying on the same, excuse me, instead of staying on the same line, I'm going to move off to his side position just by taking a little step with my right, a little step with my left. This is very good for when you have multiple opponents. He's grabbed, he's got a buddy over there, and I'm going to step over here to use him as a diversion into that other person. So again, we have same side grab, cross grabs from the front, cross grabs to the shoulder, same side grab to the shoulder. Again, same thing, I'm going to roll the arm up and over. I may step back to do that, then I might go back in, or I might move to my side position to get a better feel. Same thing with the left hand. Again, I might use the tiger mouth, or again, I might use a little bit more of a pressure-oriented, sharper point type technique to apply the initial arm bar position. Now, let's take a look at when he's at my side position. I'm facing 12 o'clock. He's at my 3 o'clock position. My right arm is going to come up, trap the arm with the palm. Again, I always want to catch to lock that elbow up, because that initial trap can break the balance. Then I just pull it in, apply the arm bar. If he grabs with his right hand, I'm going to again trap the arm, and I can either step in offensively. The reason I choose to step in is because his grab is very loose. He grabs tightly. I step back, he's going to come with me. If you notice, the feet placement in these movements is very, very important. So any art that you study, the Integrative Arts Tai Chi program is a very good compendium or associate to this stuff, because it really develops a good sense of structure and foot placement. Same thing applies on the other side. He's not my 9 o'clock. He grabs. Again, he's got a very loose grab right now, so most of the time I'd probably just knock the arm off or I would move in. He's got a tighter grab. Again, I'm going to use the outside of that elbow. Because he's got a tight grab, he's actually helping me lock him. So I've actually started to apply the arm bar here. Then I let it slide off, catch, and push in. Cross grab. Again, cross grab, I'm going to either step forward with my right foot, or I'm going to step back with my left. I'll step back with my left first. That's the simplest technique. If I step forward with my right, a lot of times, in some of the kung fu type systems, this will be considered sort of a snake style movement, because I'm going to move all the way behind him and bring him back into this position. Again, you can see very, very simple turn. He grabbed with that left hand. I stepped with my right foot behind, completely out of the way of that left. Again, I got to break his balance though, because I don't want him to spin and hit me with that right elbow. So I step, break the balance forward, step back again, keep him going that same direction, down and into the ground. Now, if he grabs me from the rear position, he grabs me with the right hand from the rear position, I don't want to step to 12 o'clock. I want to step off to 1 or 1:30. I'm going to be doing two steps. My left foot's going to step initially, just like I'm saying, hey, what's going on? You see I've cleared the arm. I then grab it, let the hand slide down, step back with my right foot. There's my arm bar. He's actually still on the same 12 o'clock line that I was on. Okay? So let's demonstrate that one more time. Again, he grabs. There's my 12 o'clock position. Again, I'm turning around. Just like I'm saying, hey, what's going on? I continue my right foot, left foot, right foot step, and there's my position for the arm bar. Same thing applied left side. He grabs. Again, I'm turning with my right foot. One, pulling, two, and three, just like I'm continuing to walk in that direction for my lock. If he grabs with the left hand to my right shoulder, this is very typical, I come around, all of a sudden I find I'm on my inside position. So to get to my outside position, I'm just going to flip my elbow. So my elbow comes up, hand comes down, left hand assists. I can use my elbow for the lock, or I can go ahead and come in with the arm bar. Same thing, other side. He's grabbing. I turn. I find I'm on the inside position. My hand's going to flip over. Right hand assists. I can actually come over the top and use my tricep, if that's where I end up at. Okay. I can use my shoulder, my ribs, my body, wherever I'm at, to actually help me position the technique with the movement. So again, when you're playing with the techniques, use the principles, because the principles apply all the way down the line. So it doesn't matter if I'm using the wrist throw here or here, or when we get to the head twist here, or if I'm using it on the foot, we again apply the principle all the way down, instead of thinking that the wrist throw is a completely different technique from the head throw or from a foot throw or from a leg take around. They are all the same. So again, the arm bar, very nice technique to be able to apply 360 degrees, right hand, left hand, inside, outside, because this exercise, this drill is a good thing to work on just by itself, and then to try to incorporate it and help you incorporate it in all of your other techniques. Also, when you're applying the arm bars, it's good to work also on when an arm bar is not working, maybe he's pulling away, to go back and strike and then come back again. So I'm applying the arm bar as he pulls in. Look how that arm folds in this position. So what does my right hand do? I just help pull it a little bit more to break the shoulder balance here, and my right hand shoots into the body, and then it comes back out to my arm bar position. So again, when we talk about when he pulls, you push. When he pushes, you pull. So you have this natural reaction. And again, this is a nice play technique to work on that feel of riding the arm bar in and out wherever he goes. Now, it's important in this next technique to again realize the principle. We're using this technique to teach you the principle, but you want to take this principle and apply it through all of the locks you've done so far. So what I'm doing is I'm coming up with a two-finger outside walk. I start to walk him, and for whatever reason, I'm not paying attention, and he jerks away. Okay? Very typical. I could be applying this to the wrist, so I'm starting to apply the wrist, so and for some reason, he's able to jerk away. And a lot of times, the mistake that people make in control techniques is that when a technique isn't working, the person's pulling away, they're chasing that hand because they've got it locked in their mind that they're going to do that specific technique. So again, your goal is never to do a specific technique. Your goal is to take control, to bring harmony and balance back to the situation that you find yourself in. So I go to do the lock, he jerks away, I immediately slap. Again, just going back to that almost the technique where we talked about the clear, I slap the solar plexus, then from there, I, as his body folds, I pull back out and I apply whatever lock. So my goal is not to do the two-finger walk along, my goal is to take control to move him out. He jerks away, I immediately slap, again, could be the groin or the body, solar plexus, then I immediately continue to take him forward, okay? Whichever way I want him to go. I may need to take him to the ground first before I can take him forward. Same thing, if I'm applying the wrist throw and he pulls away, boom, I immediately strike that shoulder. Okay, then I just come to a different arm and continue to break that balance to be able to take him where I want to take him at. And a lot of times when you're playing with those techniques, you're going to find that you're going to make up your own techniques, because that's what you're going to have to do in adrenaline-packed situations. You want to be moving from your principles, you want to be moving from your intentions, you want to be moving from your goals, not from specific techniques. That's why it is important to train and train and train and play with this material, because then it becomes subconscious. You become unconscious competent at it. And until you get to the point where you don't have to think about it, it just becomes natural, you're going to find that you're going to get glitches. And that's why you want to train as much as you can in the safe space of your dojo or your training facilities. This is a very simple technique. It's a knife disarm, but it can also be used in a lot of other situations. Mark here has a knife in my throat. Okay, again, he's using the knife as a technique to intimidate me, threatening me. This, again, is not designed in any way to be an answer to knife combatives where you can be slashing, thrusting. Again, there's a whole series of techniques that are very, very good for learning to be a knife, being better at knife combatives. But this, again, is for somebody who doesn't really know how to use a knife. They're just using it as a threatening instrument. Could be a pen or a pencil even. So what I'm going to do, as he's threatening me with that, again, giving me commands, I'm going to say, I'm going to do whatever you want. You know, just don't hurt me. My right hand is going to come in and catch into the medial nerves, the radial nerves, the ulnar nerves. My left hand is going to catch here at the wrist, at the top of the hand. So that this area is where the wrist folds. So that's where we want to get those two to hit simultaneously. Now what we do is we don't want to do it hard. We want to do it very soft. We want to use that soft kinetic energy slap position to take that out. Now from that position, I then have to apply whatever control technique I want. Now again, you can see here, I'm actually using a thumb lock. We talk about the two-finger lock. Well, you can also use that same principle with the thumb, and it's just as painful. And I'm using a bit of an arm bar in that position as well. So again, after you do the knife takeaway, the knife disarm, with that slap, you want to then be able to follow up. Now, in some cases, I might get to here, I might get the slip, and the knife may not be gone, in which case, that's okay. I want to still maintain my control and follow into another technique. This is where your bonus technique in the 16 handlock drill comes in, because that's where we're at. We're able to take him down, throw him into a wall, be wherever we're at in position. The folding block works here at the wrist, okay, which we've shown you. Okay, it also works at the arm, at the base of the bicep, okay, and the wrist to be able to take it there. We can also use it into the bicep itself. You just want to make sure that if you use it in those positions that you do not end up being in here and smack yourself through the head as you fold it in. So again, using the technique at the appropriate place, very important in all of your techniques and drills. This next technique is a very simple takedown or control technique using the sternoclinomastoid, this big group of muscles in through here. We can also actually even go into the trapezius muscle as well. As I come in, this is a rear approach position. I'm coming in, I'm going to trap the elbow. I'm going to break his balance forward first. Then I'm going to grab and pull back and down and in. Okay. Again, I can use the trap muscle. I can also use the sternoclinomastoid, which is even more painful. With this technique, I'm generally going to use it to take him all the way down and into the ground for another type of controlling type mechanism. If we look at that from the rear position, again, and this is also very good for if you're running, if somebody's running from you, instead of, if Matt is running from me and all of a sudden he feels my fingers on his back, what that's going to do is that's going to give him a burst of adrenaline and he's going to shoot away from me. So it's important that if you're having to chase somebody, what you want to do is, as you get close to them, you want to make sure that instead of trying to grab them, that you are pushing them, okay? So if they're trying to run away from you, if they're going this direction, you want to go the same direction, because as you push them and they're going away, they're going to want to slow down, not lose their balance, in which case then as they're trying to stop, you then come back from this other position. You can see again, I'm controlling the hand here, and I'm also controlling the hand here. You can see the difference in reaction between the trapezius and the sternoclinomastoid position, okay? And again, you just take them all the way down to the position to where you can control them. Very simple technique, SCM control. Again, I can also pull them this way with it. I can push them with it, but again, I'm just gripping in there. One of the key things in the martial arts this kind of ties into is that a lot of times when we grab, we can actually grab the entire bicep for more control. We can grab the tricep for more control. So when I'm actually grabbing that, I'm actually getting a feel for grabbing that, and that gives me a lot more control. Again, as I'm taking that slack out there too, I could be grabbing the pec for control, I could be grabbing the ribs for control, or the muscle there. Again, you have a lot of skin to be able to take control. Very painful areas that when you grab and grip, okay, gives you the ability to take more control, and it causes a lot of pain immediately. As you can see from just some of the different effects on his face when we're grabbing some of these different positions. Okay, so again, when you grab, make sure you take control. Make sure you don't just grab somebody. Make sure you break their balance as you control. And again, we can use soft touches initially when we're working, But you want to keep in mind that you can also really grab in to that flesh with those hands. And so gripping strength, something good to develop to help you with your techniques. This next technique is very simple. Dave's going to grab me with his right arm. And we sort of showed you this technique very simple in the arm bar reversal, where we were on the inside position and we went to the outside position. This is called a wing takedown. What I'm going to do is, instead of using my arm bar, maybe I've got an opponent or somebody who's grabbed me and I don't really want to come up, so I'm going to bring my elbow up, palm is down. Again, I trap at the wrist area. I'm not grabbing the wrist, I'm just trapping there, pushing it into the body, using my structural integrity to do a lot of the work for me, and I roll the arm over using the back of the arm, again, to do most of my work for me. Again, he can grab with his right arm, same thing. You can see my arm comes up. I can actually, this is a good way to actually apply this, is to actually bring your left arm down, your right arm up, to actually trap this way, okay? To just practice, boom, this kind of movement. Right from there, my hand comes over the top, and again, I'm breaking it. I actually want to be breaking this initial motion just to kind of slap and strike, but I actually want to be doing that as I'm stepping back to break the balance, and my hand comes up, rolls over, and there's my takedown. You can see, putting the pressure right alongside the elbow. So it's basically another version of an arm bar, and I'm again applying the wrist grab here too. So if we look at it from this side again, from this arm, I come up, take it right down into position. And again, I don't really want to lean myself. Again, very common mistake you'll find is that people have a tendency to lean when they do these techniques. I want to drop my legs. I want to drop my legs, or I want to step in position. I don't want to lean forward, because then I end up going forward with him. So the wing takedown, just another very simple variation of an arm bar. It gives you another tool, another complete technique to work on. Again, this next technique is a very simple technique. It's called a head twist. Basically employs the same concept that we did in the wrist throw. Again, we push on the wrist here, we pull on the wrist here. Again, we do that at the elbow positions, okay? We're just doing that at the head position now. In this case, a lot of times, we're in a close combative situation, and I can get my hand up, I can grab the head. When I grab the head, again, I actually want to kind of strike it too. I want to kind of pat the back of his head here. I want to hit it right at the crown. As I hit forward, I then grab and pull, and I'm going to twist it sideways. Now, it's very important to do this gently, because I don't want to snap his neck. I don't want to pop it. I've had students doing their wrist throws. In reality, on people actually break the wrist. Okay, you have 8 bones in the wrist. It's very easy to snap one of those. It's very easy to snap the vertebrae here. So when you're practicing this technique, you want to make sure you twist, pull, and again, just take it to about this position initially. Good technique that's used for this is against a two-hand push. He goes to push. I just move my hands up and in, moving them down, and then I take the technique and I take him all the way to the ground for that takedown and pin. If you think about how steer wrestlers, who compared to the weight of a steer, are very small, what do? They grab the head of the steer by the horns and they twist and they throw up. Now, if the person doesn't have any hair, we can still do that throw. We just have to push up on the chin. So it's again like the center lock. We want to push the wrist towards the elbow. We push the two palms together and we use the head this way as that leverage point, because we don't actually need the hair itself to do the throw. In some cases, we can even use the ear, but we'd have to insert the thumb inside the ear to do the throw to get the position down and in, and we use the chin position as our leverage point. So again, you can push the hands together. You can use the ear, and again, you can play this technique off of lots of situations based on where you're coming from. In one of our self-defense techniques tapes, the person has us in a headlock, and from the headlock, we might strike the groin, or we might come up and grab the hair, and here I'm using that head twist right here, and we can very easily take him all the way to the ground from that head position. So depending upon how you incorporate this with other movements, you can incorporate it into other techniques or use it by itself, because they stand alone. But again, you can look at applying them in other situations as well. Now, the last technique we're going to show you today is a K-bar technique. And this technique is most of the time something you're not going to use. But again, it's another tool that can help you develop your skills. In this case, Dave's throwing a big right-hand punch. Most of the time, I'm going to block that punch. I'm going to strike the bicep. I'm going to strike the arm here, and then I'm going to strike into the neck, or I'm going to follow up with any number of techniques or strikes. Or as he goes to throw that big punch, I'm going to beat him to the punch. Or as he goes to throw that big punch, I'm going to move in, hit first again. Or I'm just going to move out of the way. So the K-bar, again, is a controlling technique against a big right-hand punch. Again, he comes in. I'm going to block with my ulna on both sides, and I'm generally going to use this technique because I want to continue going that direction. Maybe I'm already going in that direction. All of a sudden, he's there. So I just want to continue to go. As I hit, I'm going to roll this hand forward and this hand over. So my hands are sort of doing this sort of Ferris wheel or water wheel type effect. I'm going to bring this hand over here. I'm going to bring this here. I want to make sure this misses my head. I don't want to knock myself out in that position. I come over and grab my arm here, and I continue to go in this position. And you can see his balance is starting to break at that point. So as he throws the punch, I'm coming in, I strike it, and I continue to come in this position, and I continue to come back, down, and in. Okay. Again, when you're doing these techniques, you can take them nice and slow, you can take them nice and hard. I'll tell you, when you do this hard right here, that's going to destroy that bicep. He's going to have a hard time using it for a while. And again, the motion just continues to go and roll down. So you want to make sure if you're practicing with people that you're doing it slow initially. If you do take them to the ground, make sure they have some ground work experience, because you do not want to be doing this with somebody who's inexperienced in falling. Again, the K-bar technique, basic technique that you would not want to use very often, but it's a good technique to work on, again, developing more control in various situations. Some of you may have seen this tool before. This is a Kubaton or a Hesitan. It's a self-defense keychain. They come in all different shapes and sizes. We could actually even use pens. You can use telephones, anything that basically has any kind of a structural integrity to it. And what this does, this basic tool, will allow you to incorporate and maximize. You can incorporate any of your techniques, and it'll also maximize your tools. For instance, if Dave grabs my wrist and I have that in my hand, what this does is gives me a lot more structural integrity to be able to apply any of my locks. Makes it a lot more painful. Also, when we think about the thumb here, we want the same structure here with that hand. I can use this for my arm bar, okay, putting pressure in. This will really go into the pressure points very effectively. And this is a deadly force weapon. In law enforcement, if we talk about, or in security work, if we talk about breaking somebody down, most of the time we want to attack the musculature of the body. But in self-defense situations, if we're in serious situations and we need to use, we're justified in using deadly force, these same tools would be used to attack the skeletal system. And just a little tool like this on the skeletal system, just tapping on, you know, different areas, you can feel how it would cause serious physical injury. So again, a very nice little tool that can help you to maximize your techniques in terms of breaking balance, taking control, causing pain, and assisting you in the tool. Again, it doesn't matter if he's got my right hand and I can't move my right hand, I can still get position to use it later because I still have my left hand. So one of the most important things with tools also is if you have something like this, whether you have mace, tear gas, pepper spray, guns, nightsticks, never put your faith in your tools, keep your faith in yourself, and use the tool as it is situated for to help you in the situation to achieve your goals. So the goal of this tape has been to impress upon you the importance of having a clear goal. Then you can direct your energy through the techniques, which you've learned a lot in this tape, the best fit the various situations you encounter to achieve your goal. It's very important as you're employing those techniques that your techniques remain flexible and adaptive. So you can move from soft to hard. You can move from linear to lateral. You can move from an inside position to an outside position. And you can move from an offensive position to a defensive position based on what's going to best fit the situation again you're encountering. Being able to flexibly and fluidly move through your techniques and through your techniques as they fit the situation you encounter is paramount in the training. Again, as you train, use all the training to help you work on your inner skills. Don't take things personally. You want to find your weaknesses and what doesn't work in safe space instead of when you walk out of your training facility, finding out what doesn't work in unsafe space. So in training facilities, we really have no place for egos. We want to, again, use that as a way for all of us to test and see what works and what does not work for us. So I hope that you can all get it together in your training and develop your knowledge, increase your knowledge, your power, your inner harmony, and your conflict resolution skills as you are out there in the battlefields that you encounter every day, whether they're in a classroom, something as simple as a classroom, or in the streets where gangs and more lethal force is necessary to be used.
Thank you.